for girls, for all that she is a principal in almost all that follows, I have obtained, and have sought to obtain, no information whatever. There is the question of the lady's feelings, and in this case I gather they are of a peculiarly complex sort. Quite naturally they would be. At any rate, the natural ruthlessness of the literary calling has failed me. I have not ventured to touch them. The villa residences to the east of Sandgate Castle, you must understand, are particularly lucky in having gardens that run right down to the beach. There is no intervening esplanade or road or path, such as cuts off 99 out of the 100 of houses that face the sea. As you look down on them from the western end of the Lees, you see them crowding the very margin. And as a great number of high groins stand out from the shore along this piece of coast, the beach is practically cut off and made private, except at very low water, when people can get around the ends of the groins. These houses are consequently highly desirable during the bathing season, and it is the custom of many of their occupiers to let them furnished during the summer to persons of fashion and affluence. The Randolph Buntings were such persons, indisputably. It is true, of course, that they were not aristocrats, or indeed what an unpaid herald would freely call gentle. They had no right to any sort of arms, but then, as Mrs. Bunting would sometimes remark, they made no pretense of that sort. They were quite free, as indeed everybody is nowadays, from snobbery. They were simple, homely Buntings, Randolph Buntings, good people, as the saying is, of a widely diffused Hampshire stock addicted to brewing, and whether a suitably remunerated herald could or could not have proved them gentle, there can be no doubt that Mrs. Bunting was quite justified in taking in the gentlewoman.